I'm Eileen Peters and I'm going to tell you about my proposal today, and I'm also going to zoom in on my first study. And I have a few questions for you, so hopefully we can have a little in-depth discussion and you can help me in my progress of my PhD. I first like to say something about myself.
Oh,
met de muis. Well, I was born and raised in Maastricht, and I also studied here at Maastricht. And I also studied in Maastricht. I studied psychology with a master of neuropsychology at the UM. So I'm what is called a Wiel Zheng. But recently I moved out of Maastricht and moved to Geul. Oh, there we go again. And this is actually my view. I took this picture from my front yard, so this is the view that I have right now. You can see it's a little bit different. In Geul, there live like 1,200 people, and I think the average age is like 70. But it is really nice there and really quiet, so I really like it now. In my free time, I like to play sports. I play softball. And for people who don't know what softball is, it's just like regular baseball, but then it's the curly version. And this is actually our field at Maastricht, and that's me. it's really nice to do. And last year I started here as a PhD student at the Passamaker Project, and Passamaker Project is about palliative care education. And we are with 7 women in one team. For those who are wondering, that's going well. I want to introduce to you my team members. First, you can see Franke Warmerhoven and Judith Weston. They are both part-time project leader. Then you see Danielle Verstegen and Diana Dolmans, who we all know. And then you can see Marieke van den Beuken and Annemie Koertens, who work at the hospital. And Danielle and Marieke are my co-promoters, and Diana is my promoter. As I said, Passamaker is about palliative care education. But first, I'd like to give you some more information about what palliative care is. Palliative care is care for patients who are facing a life-threatening illness or a terminal illness. And it is a very complex kind of care. It is very broad. It encompasses the whole patient. And it does that by focusing on 4 components. And I want to show you that by example. This is my grandmother. She passed away a few years ago, but she was a very independent and a little rebellious woman. And a few years before passing, we started to see some behavioral changes, and we also noticed some memory deficits. So we went with her to the hospital, and she got the diagnosis of dementia. And from that moment on, also palliative care started. Palliative care focusing on 4 components. And the first component is the physical component, and that is the treatment of the drugs. And the treatment of the drugs are focusing on improving quality of life and not on getting someone better. For instance, my grandmother, she got very nervous and anxious during her time of her dementia, so she got drugs to reduce that anxiety. And she didn't get any drugs to, of course, make her better, because unfortunately we can't do that right now. The second part is the spiritual part. When you hear that you have this life-threatening illness, you are going to reflect on your life. Maybe you have guilt or remorse on some aspects, or maybe you are going to wondering what will happen to me after I die. So the spiritual part is more than religion, but religion is of course a big part of it. The third part is the emotional part. You come in this roller coaster when you hear this diagnosis, and also your emotions go up and down. And for my grandmother, the main emotion that she felt was frustration. She got really frustrated in the beginning that she couldn't do things anymore, that we had to help her. And in the end, she really got frustrated about the fact that she couldn't make herself clear anymore. So when she wanted to talk to you, she didn't know the words which she would use. So she got really frustrated about that. And the fourth part of palliative care is the social part. Not only are you going to reflect what will happen to me after I die, but you can also think what will happen to my family after I die, especially when you are in a younger age. but you can also lose your role in society. But my grandmother, she used to take care of me, of my sister, and now we had to take care of her, which is the other way around, and you lose your role as a grandmother. But if you are younger, maybe you have to quit your job, and you just lose your role in the society, or at least it changes. So as you can see, palliative care focuses on these four components, and it is really broad and it is really complex. Now, in the last 40 years, the palliative care awareness rises, but also in the clinical practice, we saw more and more palliative care patients. That's, of course, due to that we are aging, we become older, but also that people have more chronic diseases. And when you see in the clinical practice that you have more palliative care patients, you should also look at the education that we give junior doctors. Now, and if we look at that education, there was in 2004, Williams and McLeod stated that education about palliative care is really fragmented and there is a little consensus. Then 10 years later, the European Association of Palliative Care stated that medical curricula in Europe devote little attention to palliative care. So there's a 10 years difference, but still the necessary steps were not made yet. And then the Dutch organization in 2015 stated that there was a lot of attention in the medical education about how should we treat these patients, but not on the question, should we treat this patient? If you look at our surrounding countries, you can see that other European countries took action on this. Great Britain is actually very leading in this and has a lot of research going on palliative care, but also on palliative care education. And in Germany, it is since 2014 mandatory to give palliative care education in the medical curricula. In the Netherlands, this has not yet been done. So what are we going to do, or what needs to be done, is that we mend the gap between what students learn at a university and what they should know when they go into practice. And as Pacy Maker Group, we said, we had a little Barney Stinson and we said, challenge accepted. Yeah. Our main goal is to integrate palliative care education in the undergraduate medical curricula at all 8 medical universities. And we are going to do that by developing, implementing, and evaluating a toolbox. So we are going to develop a toolbox with educational materials, and we do that based on the 4CID model. We're going to implement that at different universities, and then we're going to evaluate that. And we are going to do that in 4 different studies, because it's actually my whole PhD. And we do that in 4 studies. And in the first studies, we are going to look at which competencies do junior doctors actually need to have. And I will zoom in on that study later. In the second study, we are going to develop the toolbox with educational material based on the competencies that we found in study 1. And then in study 3, we are going to evaluate the toolbox. And in study 4, we're going to measure its effects. If we look at study 1, about the competencies, then we did a few things. Oh. We went into the literature, and we found different competencies already being made, but it was all in other countries than in the Netherlands. And we are going to do a Delphi study, which I will tell you more about. We also asked the students. So 6 years medical students got an online questionnaire, and we asked them, what do you think about the palliative care education? What do you miss? What do you find important? Do you feel secure if you have to give palliative care? So we asked that as 6 years medical students at 4 different universities. And we also do patients interviews. So we are going to ask patients, what do you find important? Which qualities does a doctor need to have to give good palliative care? Currently, we are busy with the data collection of the patient interviews and the student questionnaire, and we are now working on the Delphi study. And in the Delphi study, we went to the literature and we found all these competencies, and we translated these competencies to EPAS. And there were actually 6 EPAs, main EPAs found, and each main EPA had its sub EPAs, of course. And the 6 main EPAs that we found was that the junior doctor needs to communicate well with the patient and its system. He or she needs to can make advanced care planning, is able to relieve suffering, gives care surrounding the death of the patient, so that is really of the moment of dying and the moments afterwards. Feels responsible for personal well-being, because it is a very emotional kind of care to give, so the junior doctors need to have the ability to also take care of themselves. And of course, they have to work in a multi and interdisciplinary team, which is also important at all other specialties. Now, we found all these EPAs and sub-EPAs, and we want to validate this list. And we are going to ask 5 groups of stakeholders, what do they think about these EPAs? And the panel consists first out of experts, so that are doctors and nurses who are really experts at palliative care. The second group are physicians who are not experts but regularly come in contact with palliative care patients. The third group are the nurses. And nurses are really important because they work most closely to junior doctors. The fourth group are the curriculum coordinators and educators, for the educational view, of course. And the fifth group are the junior doctors, because that is the group that we actually want to have. So at this point we are now, we are doing our pilot study and we will soon send out the Delphi study. But I've got a few questions about that, because we were thinking what will happen if no consensus is reached even within one single group. Because we can imagine that all experts think that everything is important and they should know everything. But what if curriculum coordinators or nurses think quite differently, and even in one group think quite differently? And my second question is, maybe do you have tips or tricks that can keep the stakeholders interested? Because if we're going to send the list back for the second time, or maybe for the third time, we still want to have a high response, of course. So maybe you have tips or tricks to get the stakeholders interested. That was my presentation.